Game sequels always have a hard time to stand out. They need to be better than the first one in many aspects. Yet, how they do it all depends on how they deal with it. Improve parts what did work they have already done. Small difference so it is close to the original. Or change up big times that's nowhere near close to the original. Final Fantasy II is one of those games. Have heard from people that this game is not for everyone in the series just because they change up the gameplay of it. I wonder why, so that is why we are here to find out. Rebels Against the Empire, here is my Final Fantasy II for the very first time. Beginning the game, we see our heroes are running away from the Empire and his army. They just destroyed their home village as he wants to destroy the world and rule it. Sadly, they were not fast enough to run from the army and they were killed with no hesitation. Laying on the floor with their last breath, they were saved and resurrected by the Rebellion army leading by Hilda, the princess of the Kingdom of Finn. Princess Hilda tells us that it was only three of us that they found resurrected us because of her strong life. All heroes want to thank her for joining the Rebellion against the Empire after what they have done to their village. She refuses, but we are welcome to live here and talk to the Rebellion with the keyword, the Wild Rose. Not sure what they can do, they decide to walk to the village of the Kingdom of Finn, hoping they can find Leon there, the older brother. Talking to the right person in the bar with the keyword, let us go inside a hidden floor where we can see the Crown Prince of Kushan, Scott, who is mortally wounded in bed. The prince tells us we need to give his ring to the princess Hilda, that he loves her. But then he changes his mind to spare her heart. With his last breath, he dies with the wounds and all heroes tell about it that Scott has passed away as proof with this ring. Hilda, breaking in tears, what she heard must stay strong and allows us to join the Rebellion against the Empire and hope we can find her older brother Leon wherever he may be so that the heroes can go back to their old lives. This story is all about moving on to all the hardship we make along our journey. Our three heroes just want to find their older brother as they are in the middle in a war they never wanted. Yet to go through it all and hope that the war will end where everyone can go back to normal what it once was. I like the darker tone on this story. Does not mean it is a good story. You can easily tell what will be happening in the game. Princess tells us where we need to go with the keyword. We go to that place where the Empire's army is there. Befriend one of the four characters with that keyword that will be our fourth playable character in the party. Going to the dungeon where the fourth playable character can do it with the key item against the Empire. Fourth playable character dies / leaves in the end to save us because we give hope to the Rebellion. Repeat it with some time to time, shake it up for a little bit. The key item thing sounds like a good idea at first, if it became not the only thing to progress the story. You only get more keywords to use that will stagger. Had no problems with it since I was carefully reading the story what I need to say to the right person with the right keyword. Worst thing about the story is our three heroes we follow don't really have much of a development after the intro. Okay, there's a small bit of lore for everyone to fill in for almost everyone. Firion is the voice of reason. Easily follows the command of the princess, even for stuff he is not allowed. Maria just wants to go back before the war. Also, she thinks that the one of the generals of the Empire is the older brother because they have the same voice. Guy, small, kind talks that can talk to beavers for some reason. All the development goes to the side characters we meet along an adventure before they die or leave. Let's talk about the biggest thing that is within Final Fantasy II for everyone. The gameplay system. In a normal classic JRPG game, you have random encounters in your journey, you fight against them, and if you kill them, you get experience and level up to get stronger. Repeat it, but every encounter will get harder and harder over time. There's none of that here. If you want to get stronger with a specific weapon, then use that specific weapon. If you want to have better spells, then use those specific spells in battle. Want to have more HP? Then get hit and don't get healed. They all start with level 1 and everything has to be trained separately. If there's anything you want to train, you can do it. Just make sure what you will train your heroes and stick with it. So every encounter you make is not about the enemies you can kill for experience, but how many times you need to do it against them so what you are training gets better over time. Don't worry if you kill the enemies too fast, there will be plenty of random encounters in your journey. A bit too much if you ask for me, with big dungeons, with hidden pathways, with no clue, for super rare chests, or open a doorway with forced encounters raids, with very difficult enemies where you need to think before you can act. This was also the game that introduced mimics into the chest for the series, so be careful if you open up a chest just beforehand. So every encounter in general, you need to think before you can act, not only pressing the swinger sword against the enemy and hope for the best. If you are a person who likes that idea, to get better over time for using that skill or weapon, then you might enjoy it. Everyone has their own way how they like their journey in this JRPG game. As for me, I had a strict role for everyone in the party. Firion using a sword and shield in the early game with thunder spells if we need it. Maria the red mage, as I like to call her, with a bow on sight to hit the enemies in the back row, and if their defense were too high, she has fire spells up for tricks. Guy, a supportive man with supportive buffs, heals, and if that is not needed, he has a big axe for the boots. Keeping it so straight makes me have a more fun time with this game. Only focusing on skills and what I want on the specific characters. The only thing that I'm not so big of a fan of is the formation in this game. Your heroes can be in the front or back row. If you put heroes in the back row, they can only be damaged with magic spells or bow, until the front row is dead. Same goes for the enemies as well. If there are enemies with status ailments in the back row, then oh boy, I hope you are prepared, since there are more enemies that can do that in a wimp. So stack up to your element items and get ready for it. Is there anything more that we can talk about when it comes to the gameplay system of Final Fantasy 2? Well, yes, there's a big elephant in the room. You can hit yourself in this game, and for some reason, people suggest you need to do that to level up your HP and get an easier time with the game. For the person who ever came up with that idea, you only make yourself harder, in my honest opinion. Just play the game how you want it and stick what you want with your heroes. If you stick with it, you are going to have a wonderful time with the game. The game is not hard if you just play it like me when it comes to the PSP version of it. Yep, the PSP as well. This is also kind of the same look as the 20th anniversary of Final Fantasy 1. Same assets as the first one, only with weird visual glitches. With small life improvements in stores such as Eaters and Elictus for a very high price. Music is as always amazing as the first one. I have to say it's even better with this one if I have to say so myself. So people, please, if you have time, give it a listen to it. I just cannot thank them more than enough how wonderful this music sounds. Also, I don't know how to say it for an odd reason, but I like the visual designs more in this game compared to the first one. Maybe it has to do we can see face icons who are talking, except for the simple four basic designs of the Warriors of Light. Speaking of warriors, where are they now? Let's see, they find rare materials for the rebellion thanks to the Guide of Minwu, saved slaves that were working to make a warship, asked Cid for how to destroy the warship, found the bell in the ice cave thanks to Joseph with a snowcraft. Sadly, he did sacrifice himself after the boss fight when he triggered a Triforce. Used the bell to get access to the castle with help of Gordon, the younger brother of Scott, where we find fire against the Empire warship. Get inside the warship thanks to the keyword password, where we save the princess and Cid that were also in there. They were captured as we were hunting down the way to destroy the warship. Time to destroy it, we did it, and the war is not over. Going back to the rebellion's place, the king is dying with his wounds. Yes, there was also a king, but he was not big in the story in general. He tells us to end the war, we need to ask aid for the dragoons in the east. Powerful dragon riders knights with extreme powers. As Minwu is going to get the most powerful spell, Ultima, somewhere in the west. The only way to get there is to ask from the pirate captain Layla. Even though she wanted to rob us from the ship, we still hire her against the Empire. With her help, we find all that the people in the east died thanks to the Emperor. Only a child, mother and a dying old dragon. From the mother, we need to find a necklace to let us talk to the dying dragon in their cave. We found one on the corpse of a dead dragoon, where we used the necklace to talk to the dragon, where in his last breaths wants us to go back to the cave to lay the last surviving egg in a pool of water, where it one day will hatch and help us out. Returning to the rebellion with sad news, we notice that the princess is acting strange. She wants to be alone with Virion, and how she puts it, take me hero. Thankfully, in the nick of time, Layla slams the door open and reveals it is not a princess, but a Medusa enemy. The real princess is captured again and she will be gifted out as reward in the arena thanks to the Emperor. Gordon wants to join us to save her because he's also in love with her and wants to prove that he is a hero. Riding there thanks to the chocobos, we arrive there and we need to prove to the Emperor to defeat his bet, the behemoth, where we kill it in one turn. Oops. Well, we did it, and what do we get for a reward? In jail. Well, you see, it was the Empire's trap to lay us upon his hands and put a spell on us when we were close to him. So now we are trapped and put in jail. Nowhere to go, we get thankfully saved by the thief who is going to save us as a repay what we did to him way back at the start of the game. Being saved with the princess, it's time that the princess wants to get the Kingdom of Finn back with revenge. It is a simple job since the front gate was open and the throne is right there in the middle, so it was not all too difficult. After reclaiming our castle, the princess tells us it's time that we help Minwu to get the ultimate spell in the west. Going to the west to prove ourselves to the mages that we can use the ultimate spell. We just need to find two masks first in the tropical island. Now it's time to go to the Mycidian Tower to prove ourselves where we get swallowed by the Leviathan. Inside his stomach we found the last Dragoon Knight. He will help us to get out of here as we prove ourselves in the tower where we fight three element giants. At the top of the tower we see Minwu sacrificing himself, opening up a sealed door where inside we get the ultimate power and some power buffs. Those power buffs is what we really needed because the Empire is really pissed now. So mad in fact, he is using a typhoon to destroy cities where we no longer can visit them. Back at the castle, we ask what to do now. All they can think of a hidden legend where we need to use the mirror using an item to activate it. Only the thief that saved us knows where that item is, a hidden location inside the castle. Oh, also a hidden room in his house for the most useful weapon in the game, the blood sword. 100% lifesteal, thank you. Now we use that key item in the big mirror to reveal a little dragon. It's the dragon egg we put into the water back in the east. Thanks to the dragoon, we can ride the little dragon, and now we can get inside the typhoon. Inside, we get face to face with the Empire and his best army, and now we can defeat him, the reason why everything is in ruin. After we bonk his head, the war is finally at its end. The world is saved and everyone is dancing to celebrate the moment. Not for long, since the general is now taking over the kingdom and he wants the war to go on. And he is the missing brother we have been looking for all this time. Asking Cid if he can use his airship one more time as he is dying in bed because of the typhoon. We are allowed to use his ship, but only if we take good care of her. We will, and we fly all the way to the castle that was once from the Empire next to the Colosseum. As we approach him, we ask what's the deal with our brother. He says the only way to live is for the strong, and he has learned it after we have almost died at the start of the game. Before he strikes his weapon at our heroes, Maria steps in to shout out that this is crazy and Leon needs to go back to his old self before the war. But all of a sudden, the Empire is back with a new demonic loop. He has taken all over hell and he is now back and he wants to destroy the world with his new power. That Empire that we just killed came back from hell, beat the devil out of it, and came back to the living just to continue his quest to destroy the world. Now with this new power, he wants to kill us all, but thanks to the Dragoon Knight sacrificing himself, we can escape on top of the baby dragon. Back at the castle, it's up to the four main heroes you pick the names from to kill the Empire again inside this new castle that is all of crystal, that is inside of hell. To go there, we need to go to the gate between the living and the dead, that is the Jade Passage. Before we go to the final place, let's stock up of everything and talk to the mother and child of the last dragoon that he has passed away for saving us. The mother cries, but will thank us with the information and reward us with the sword Excalibur. Now, let's go to the Jade Passage. And holy damn, this really wants you to be at your A game at this. Enemies that can steal your MP. Enemies with all status elements on you if it is a bad breed. And hope you like fake doors with hidden pads. Thankfully, our three heroes are more for ready for this. But not for Leon, since he joined in very late and is so undertrained. So he will be the item guy in this team. With trial and error, with a little help of a secret shop under the waterfall, the best spells that we need, we are finally inside the crystal castle. Let's see, how bad can this be? Ah, oh, look at those goo dorkies, they only do zero damage. Get me out of here! And as we try to go deeper, there are more hidden paths for some reason where we find the ultimate rare sword inside the chest, the Masaizune. If you find the right chest it is, since some chests are filled with bosses, some returning bosses and some bosses that are fleeing from you for your first encounter. Okay, then let's go to the Emperor and his castle throne. He tells us even that we are brave for going into hell to kill him, there's no hope because he's the strongest that there is. Here it is, our last fight. Our four heroes against the Empire who has taken over hell with his new body. For this final fight, it's pretty much in the pocket. Just make sure you hit him with a bloodsword since that's the only effective sword against him. But be prepared. If he hits you with his fist, then he gets the 100% lifesteal back of it. With the final bonk, the evil Empire has been killed once again, and the world is saved. Everyone is congratulating us and will tell us what they will be doing now into the future. As for the heroes, they want to go back before the war, but Leon says so much is happening right now and we cannot do that. Virion agrees and lets Leon go, and one day when we see them again, we will get his revenge. Once Leon is gone, our hero asks what we shall do next with one simple answer. This is only the beginning as they set out to explore what the journey has in store for them. Alright, we forgot about the extra add-ons that was on the PSP. We have extra dungeons in the PSP version with random generated floors built up from your keywords, where in the end of every dungeon we have to fight against an optional boss that was in Final Fantasy 1-6. No thank you. The biggest thing that we have as an add-on is the side content, Soul and Rebirth, where you play as four side characters that are going to the Jade Passage, trying to figure out why they are still alive. All they have in common is that they help the three young heroes to defeat the Empire one way or another. Bad thing is that they have to farm everything from the start again in a late game area with late game monsters. All what you need to know is that the four side characters are going back to the Crystal Tower that is a mirrored version of itself with an angel empire on its side. Excuse me, what? Yeah, the angel tells us before the Emperor died he split his soul into two, where one takes over hell and the other one takes over heaven. And with a brave effort he wants to give us immortality at the cost of the world. They all agree to not take part of it in a deal, but instead wants to bonk the angel Emperor. Doing that gives us a point of view for them in the ending, where we see their last word before they fade away. Final Fantasy 2 is one of those games most people may be offsetting about it just because it plays different what they are used to. So many things in this game I can say they were inspiration for the rest of the Final Fantasy series. We have a story. We have chocobos, the most sweet animal birds that we can ride. Most original the monsters design as the Behemoth and the Malbro, such an icon in the series. We have Cid, single and multi-target with your spells, with many more to talk about. I have a great time with this game and I highly recommend it for people that want to play a different kind of an old classic JRPG from the good old days. Just go with the pixel remaster from the base for the modern improvements. Now with that out of the way, it's time that we are going to look to the next Final Fantasy game in the series, Final Fantasy 3. I hope to see you all there, and bye bye everyone. Bye bye.